The content of this video is based on historical events and political developments in India during the 1950s. It is intended for educational and informational purposes only. Viewers are encouraged to approach the content with an open mind and to consider the historical context in which these events took place. The video aims to provide a balanced and objective perspective on the political, social, and economic landscape of India during this period. It is important to remember that historical analysis should be conducted with sensitivity and respect for the diverse perspectives and experiences of the people involved. Viewer discretion is advised.
With constitution getting enforced in 1950 and all the pieces of governance put into places, it was time to take action. But there was also need to rebuild a nation which was largely impoverished then. Due to the years of exploitation by the local rulers, the invaders and the colonizers for the majority part of the millennium. Aur ab is yug yugantar ke shoshan ke baad, the gap between the rich and the poor has broadened massively. So watch the video to get the gist of what all steps the government took and whether they were apt or not, but with just a little caveat. Don't try to judge history wearing present day's lenses. History has to be evaluated only with the circumstances corresponding then. Now, standing in 1951, India had just become fully independent, sovereign, democratic republic nation for the very first time in the history. But the years of exploitation had left the country ruined almost in all fronts. We were an agrarian country whereas the world was on industrial tilt. We relied heavily on the imports of commercial and industrial goods. Even whatever agricultural infra we had was tormented due to the partition and the World War effects. So we did not have the wealth, we did not have the infrastructure, we did not have optimal health and educational facilities. Agriculture produce was limited, poverty, unemployment and population was on high. तो ये जितने भी दुख और पेन पॉइंट्स हैं इनको आप आज भी सुन सकते हैं और महसूस कर सकते हैं, विच क्लियरली शोज द पॉलिटिकल सिस्टम ऑफ द कंट्री हैज मैसिवली फेल्ड. एनीवेज, दीज ऑल प्रॉब्लम्स लेड टू द इंट्रोडक्शन ऑफ द फर्स्ट 5-year प्लान्स. नाउ व्हाट आर 5-year प्लान्स? 5-year प्लान्स आर द प्लान्ड इकोनॉमिक डेवलपमेंट स्ट्रेटेजी अंडरटेकन टू रिजॉल्व द पर्टेनिंग इश्यूज ऑफ इंडिया एंड टू अचीव सब्सटेंशियल इकोनॉमिक ग्रोथ इन द नेक्स्ट 5 years. This concept of planned economic growth and 5-year plans was quite common and popular in the socialist and communist countries of the world and was quite in opposition with the idea of capitalism, where you give private entities and individuals a free hand to play with and achieve economic growth. But due to the issues pertaining with India, India just couldn't go with capitalism. We did not have the infrastructure to breed capitalism. Hence, we went for the planned economic growth in the form of 5-year plans. Fair enough, agar aaj hamare samne bhi aisi koi situation hoti, to shayad we would have done the same. We would have gone for the socialist principles rather than the capitalist principles. And that is why we had our first 5-year plan, aiming to develop the agricultural and industrial infrastructure, reducing the gap between the poor and the rich, and to provide the educational and health facilities to everybody in the coming next 5 years. And to tell you, the results at the end of the period were actually better than anticipated. The Constitution of India gave every citizen of the country fundamental rights from the word go. But many a times while implementing the other parts of the constitution, government faced that these fundamental rights stood contradictory. For example, while giving special reservations to the poor and the backward classes, right to equality stood as a barrier. For undertaking the land reforms, the abolition of zamindari system, right to property stood as a barrier. Freedom of speech had its own limitations. It could be used for hate speeches, it could be used for inciting an offense. So whenever the government tried to make laws on these, Supreme Court invalidated these rules on ground that they do not fall in place with the constitution. They violate the fundamental rights. The parliament can't make laws which violate the fundamental rights until they are amended. This marked the beginning of constant tussle between two pillars of democracy, the executive and the judiciary. To counter this, the interim government of the Jawaharlal Nehru brought in the first and one of the most controversial amendments to the constitution. It put reasonable restrictions on freedom of speech, on grounds of public order, friendly foreign relation, incitement to an offense, etc. It made exceptions to right against discrimination for carrying out welfare activities for poor and backward classes. By introducing 9th schedule in the constitution, it gave a way to the government to make laws for land reforms and create a shield from judicial review. Because whatever laws are put in 9th schedule would be free from judicial review. These all amendments may seem to be necessary to carry out the socialist outlook and principles of the government, but they were highly controversial and criticized by a lot of people, especially by a faction of people who believed that these amendments should be brought in by an elected government and not by an interim government, as elections were yet to take place, which I also think would have been apt and a better choice. But फिर यही तो होता है सत्ता का खेल. With such amendments to the constitution coming into place only after a year of its inception, Shyama Prasad Mukherjee, the then supply industry minister, parted ways from the government, who already had different beliefs from Jawaharlal Nehru, and started his own party Bharatiya Jansangh with the help of RSS. This Bharatiya Jansangh is actually the parent party of the current day's BJP. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee was a brilliant academician, a barrister and a politician, but he had a different way of looking at things. He believed that the special status given to the Kashmir state, which we had discussed in the 47 video, was a wrong move by the government. He also often criticized the foreign policies of the Jawaharlal Nehru government, especially in regards with Pakistan. He was also against the social and land reforms undertaken by the Jawaharlal Nehru government. But that doesn't put him or Jawaharlal Nehru in a wrong position. It is just two ways of looking at the same thing. And we as citizens of this country have to analyze any political event to the best of our understanding by looking at both sides of the coin. And then choose the candidates who match our understanding. That is actually the beauty of democracy, to put everything open and naked and then let the people decide what to hang upon, rather than bullshitting each other and making a mockery out of democracy. Because then the main event goes for a toss and it is all kyunki saas bhi kabhi bahu thi playing all around. Democracy is not opposing just for the sake of opposing, and let us see who has the most manpower and resources to solidify its position. Rather, it is a constant discord and flow of ideas and ideologies, no matter how contradictory they are, which is sadly nowhere close to be seen today. For a healthy democracy, you should have everything on your buffet, and then you, the people of the country, should choose what to have on plate. Ending it on a lighter note, to strengthen the ties and the relations among the Asian countries, and to unify Asia as a continent with formidable force, undoing the colonization impact, there was a need of an event or connection. And India was successful in initiating the process by organizing the first ever Asian Games in New Delhi, where 11 Asian countries participated and the event matched its vision. So this was all in 1951. See you in the next one, and keep sharing to let Indians know about India.